Give me a hair more oomph on the microphone when you get ready. It's always fun to, when you're first starting, to throw all this stuff at you. Okay, Leviticus chapter 1. We've been talking about the burnt offering. We've been talking about the offerings and dividing them according to the scriptures, the sin offerings and the sweet savor offerings. And the burnt offering is not an offering because of sin or because of failure or because of punishment, but the burnt offering is an offering, if you understood just the shadow, it is an offering that is continually, it's called the continual burnt offering or the continual given offering. And Leviticus talks about that, and you begin to get a little bit of an idea in verse 5. And you shall kill the bullock before the Lord and the priest, and Aaron's son shall bring the blood and sprinkle the blood round about upon the altar that is by the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and he shall flay the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. And then verse 9, but its inwards and its legs shall he wash in water, and the priest shall burn all on the altar. Burn all on the altar to be a burnt offering or burnt sacrifice. Notice these words, an offering made by fire of a sweet savor unto the Lord. See, and maybe go down just a little bit on this. That's just... A sin offering is not a sweet savor to the Lord. The sin offering is the destruction of everything he hates. This is not a sin offering. Most people think the only time you need an offering is when you mess up. With that in mind, and thinking about it being a sweet savor to the Lord and made by fire, let's turn over to Romans. Chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. Now remembering that the burnt offering is continual. It is what the Lord wants. And now, I mean, think of this. Okay, we say, okay, well, there needs to be a continual offering because we are continually in sin. That is not what this offering is about. If it's continual, it has nothing to do with sin, but it has your failure, but it has everything to do with what pleases God and is a sweet savor to him. That is so different. It's a different mentality. And therefore... Romans chapter 12, verse 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Now, this uses the phrase living sacrifice. Now, I don't know too many Christians that when they think of a living sacrifice, they have no thought of fulfilling the Old Testament reality. No thought. Living sacrifice has everything to do with sort of a concept that we're all supposed to be sacrificial. Well, okay, sort of, but well, let me just give you an example. I'm gonna shift here just for one second. I've done this before, but I haven't done it with my incredible artistry work. And that is, okay, this is, I know last time Ben drew a great hand, and I am going to outdo him just to show him that I have been practicing. Take that and suffer. Yeah, yeah. And then... I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to do another hand. And I could, but I'm holding stuff and whatever here. All right. I hate to erase the only good thing on this board. All right. Now, what I want to do, and let me go ahead and shadow this one in. This is the Old Covenant, okay? It is a shadow. The Old Testament, the Old Covenant, it was all a shadow. It was not the true. It was a semblance of the true. This one represents a true hand. This one, the shadow of that. All right. Well, if we make any leap at all, the leap that we make is the Old Testament was a shadow, and the New Testament is not a shadow of a hand, but the true hand. And Jesus came, and he fulfilled the Old Testament and put it away, okay? And he did that by this hand, but then he brought in something called Christianity that has a completely different form that, as Christians, it's our responsibility to figure out the new form. And we think we've pretty much figured out the new form, and the new form is going to church and reading our Bible and praying and all that kind of stuff. Okay, so what are we saying then? Are we saying that Jesus is not the fulfillment of everything, but he just fulfills some things? For example, the Old Testament was they went to a temple. Okay? The New Testament, we go to a church building. The Old Testament, they read the Old Testament. The New Testament is we read the New Testament. Is that the fulfillment of all things? I mean, I'm trying to get you to think. Taking a Star of David off the building and putting a steeple on it, I mean, is that really the great leap forward? Come on. I mean, I'm just trying to get you to think now, you know. And instead of praying, "Dear Jehovah," now we say, "Dear Jesus." At least it's still got a J in it. But, you know, that's only to show that we're not praying to the old shadow. We've found the new one, and so we say, you know. And all of the things that, you know, all of the things that are done now, in other words, basically what we call the fulfillment is nothing more than a new version of the old. You could almost say the new and improved, you know. I've often wondered that. You buy some product, you know, and last week it was just so-and-so, but this week it's new and improved. And my thought is it new or improved? If it's new, then it's something different. If it's improved, then it's the old made better. But it's new and improved. I don't fully get that. I also don't fully get this concept that Christianity is nothing more than that fulfilled, and now we do a bunch of different stuff, you know, also. We do different stuff. You know, most people's thought is what Jesus brought in is in Christianity is healing and miracles and all of that stuff. But Israel had healing and miracles all the time. People raised from the dead. That was nothing new to them. For Jesus to do those things, they thought he was a prophet because they were used to it. Am I right or wrong? They thought he was a prophet because prophets did that stuff. They didn't go, "Oh, it's the Messiah, for God's sake." They said, "He's a prophet because he does these kind of things and we're used to him and we're glad to have a new guy on the scene." Are you with me? So what I say is, or what I feel from the scriptures, it's saying, well, before I jump into that, let's look at this in the book of Hebrews. The book of Hebrews says, let's look at the way we look at the book of Hebrews. We say, the book of Hebrews says, there was a tabernacle, but now the real has come, and now we're part of that. And that it's a contrast. We say that the book of Hebrews is a contrast between Judaism and Christianity. It is no contrast of Judaism and Christianity. It is the showing that Christ is the fulfillment of the shadow. The real has come. That's what it is. All right. So there is no ethereal I don't want to press too hard on this because it's slip sliding away. Just like some of you. Anyway, it is it is showing. Instead, what it is showing is that the new didn't come. Let's put it this way. The new didn't come and put away the old and that's it. It's gone. The new shined and the shadow disappeared and the new is here now. We're the temple. We're the reality that God always hoped for and wanted was Him, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Different than Christ in a building. He can be in a building and the building is unchanged. Well, we're not just supposed to be changed, folks. We are supposed to radiate the very life, nature, spirit of Christ. The new has come. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Not Christianity, the hope of glory. If Christianity is the hope of glory, woe unto all of us. I mean, I'm just talking about modern-day Christianity that if you just looked at real close, if you just looked at it, you'd go, this is the hope of all mankind? That's why I say stuff like, this is the great leap forward? I mean, to me, that's like, boy, God is just, He can't do much. The best we can get out of it is we're all going to be saved from hell. Well, that's a good one, but what about now? No fulfillment now. No reality now. Oh, when He comes back, there'll be some fulfillment. Well, I thought that's why He came the first time. I mean, I thought this is it. I didn't think He came back, said this is it, and said not really, it's coming in 2,000 more years. You see what I'm saying? I mean, it's like, okay, this is it. Let's go. Like waving the start flag. You know, go, go, go. Stop. Just kidding. Yeah! You know, and the whole race stops and throws on its brakes. And no, you're going to have to mope around for another 2,000 years hoping that the start actually comes. Now, is this thing... Yeah, I think it's, I think my drawing is killing this board.
It's art.
It is art. So what is this reality? I mean, if we grasp hold of the Lord, what are we going to grasp hold of? Can I get an amen on that? Swing the cameras over here. I want everybody to meet Nicole. She's a sweet girl. I think we'll just take it down. Thank you for trying. And there she is. Got her? She doesn't like to be seen, but I think we got her on camera. Thank you, Nicole. So if we really get hold of Jesus, what are we going to get hold of? Just a Savior that saves but doesn't fully do anything until a long, long time? Or are we going to get life in us in the person of Christ so that we can overcome fear, so we can overcome impatience? So we can overcome, you just write in your little, I was going to say fill in the blank on the check, but some of you would need like several hundred checks. Impatience, critical, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, on and on and on. But we think this fulfillment here is that we can look to Jesus to help us. That's what we think. Okay, come on, follow me now. We think that the fulfillment is now we can look to Jesus. Folks, you don't think that the people could look to Jehovah for help? You don't think that they didn't look to him in their dilemmas and stuff? Yes, they did. The fulfillment is not just Jesus coming 2,000 years ago. The fulfillment is that Christ is the fulfillment, and he placed him in his body, in his temple, and through that vehicle, he can do what we could never do. In other words, we're not just praying for patience. We're praying for an increase of Christ in the temple. Well, that's different. I mean, let's just paint a scenario here. We're not saying this is true, but let's just paint a scenario here. What if everybody was constantly praying for love and more patience and more, you know, peace and more this and that? And what if God never intended after the new covenant to do that? He intended for Christ to be our peace, for Jesus to be our hope, for Jesus, for God to be love in us, for, you know what I mean? You see what I'm saying? In other words, a real connection between God and man. Emmanuel. A real connection. Hope for anybody. Why? Because no matter how messed up you are, Jesus is the replacement. You see what I'm saying? I mean, you go, you know, I remember my stepfather who had been an alcoholic and everything, and I'd try to share with him about the Lord, and he would say, no, I've done too many bad things. You know, I was in the war, and, you know, I did this, and I did, he didn't even want to talk about it. And I remember him as serious as he could be telling me, Randy, there's no hope for me. I've messed up too much. I've done too many wrong things. And I said, the deal isn't about you. It's about Christ in you. It's not about fixing you up. It's not about making you better. It's not about you getting more love, more peace, more. It's about an increase of Christ. And that is what the burnt offering is all about, is God getting the sweet savor of his Son out of us. That's it. So, what does that mean? What does it mean? He must increase, and I must decrease. What does it mean? It means to have fulfillment. Now, let's use that term in two different ways. Jesus came and fulfilled all the Old Testament shadows. Amen, amen, everybody's... Yes, I'm deep, I'm smart, I know that, and a whole lot of Christians don't, so that makes me superior. I don't know that makes you anything except more brain luggage. And if you like carrying around all that stuff, that's fine. But let's talk about fulfillment. Living in the fulfillment. You know, being fulfilled. Do you know why, one reason why people are always chasing, you know, chasing after stuff? Do you know why? Do you know why some people are always chasing after things? Because somewhere in their mind, they got it in their mind that if I have a bunch of things, I will be fulfilled. Some people chase after the opposite sex thinking, I'm going to find fulfillment, you know, I mean, you know, can you, you know, Adam noticed that he didn't have a mate. And he didn't say, well, you know, I'm leaving the garden on my hunt for Red October. Whoever he is or whoever she is. I mean, think about it. I'm leaving the garden because I don't see it here. Huh? Yeah. Oh, that makes perfect sense, doesn't it? Does it or doesn't? It makes perfect carnal sense. It makes maybe even good sense, but it doesn't make God sense. Because the one you're looking for, Adam, is not out there either. I will create her and bring her to you. Am I right or wrong? You know, oh, no, no, no. You know, can, you know, people talk about man coming out of monkeys. Can you see Adam walking around and going, well, that girl orangutan ain't that bad looking. Does that sound a little weird to anybody? I mean, like, really sort of weird? Okay, let me paint a weird picture for you. Walking around the zoo, looking at things, going, well, that doesn't look too bad because my biological clock is ticking down. Is it not the same thing? That orangutan doesn't look too bad. And you may be looking at, as far as what God is concerned for you, you may be checking out a monkey. I mean, personally, I've, you know, spent some time with some of these guys here, girls, and I'm telling you. You may be checking out a monkey here. Fulfillment. We're talking about fulfillment. You know, I mean, let's move on from that. I don't want to get anybody uncomfortable, like all of you. No. I have a way of doing that. But I mean, it can be anything. I mean, you're running after this, running after that, running after this. And I'll tell you exactly why we do that. Because we haven't found fulfillment and we're looking for it. Now that is the reason, folks. Because when you find it, you're fulfilled. Am I right or wrong? But if you find something you want to call it, you can put a label on it and call it it, but it ain't. Let me make a difference between the one and it. The one is God's one. It could pretty much be just it. What? An orangutan, there you go. You know, they roll their lips up and stuff. Oh man, maybe she can kiss good. You have fallen incredibly. You have made the great fall because now you're considering anything. Anyway. You know, God has exactly what you need, but I'll tell you what, you can't find fulfillment in anything without the Lord filling it up. Fulfillment is filled full. The Lord has to fill it up. That's why even Christian marriages, a lot of people are not satisfied in Christian marriages because it's not Christ, it's Christian. What do? Well, they go to church together. They pray over their meals. They have worship music on in the car and in the home. They have Christian pictures on the wall. Not sure what. Oh, yes. And they have plaques on the wall. Jesus is the so-and-so guest at every dinner, da-da-da-da. Folks, he's not supposed to be a guest in your home. You're supposed to be his home. You're not supposed to make a Christian home. You're supposed to be the home of Christ. He's not supposed to show up for dinner. He's supposed to live in you and dwell in you and manifest and express himself through you. Can I get amen? See, and most plaques don't do that, you know, unless it's like, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I. Christ lives in me. At every meal, in every argument, in every, you know what I'm saying, and all. Jesus is my life. And a true Christian home is nothing more than to bring husband and wife and children into oneness of spirit and life with Christ. Not for everybody to be saved. Because he said, I'll live in you and walk in you. You know, I mean, how do you build a Christian home? You know, it's like I was at a Christian bookstore not too long ago, and I went in, and they had a little jar, and it said, what was it, Christian lollipops. I'm in a Christian bookstore, and it says Christian lollipops. I pulled it out, and I looked at it, and I said, is this lollipop saved? I said to the person behind the counter. Are all these lollipops born again? Is that what makes them different? Or are they made in the same factory and you just slap a different label on it? You know, you see, I mean, there's a whole culture that has left Christ as the fulfillment of all things in us. And it's just become, well, we believe in the right God. Well, the Jews believed in the correct God. And they were a shadow. Well, the Jews read God's book. The Jews prayed to the right God. The Jews did everything we did, except Christ or God did not live in them. They lived for God. Am I right or wrong? I mean, the good news, folks, is not just that I'm not going to hell. The good news is I'm not going back to Randy. I'm never going back to Randy. I'm not going back to me. I'm not going back to my lifestyle. I'm not going back to my ways. I'm not going back to my mind. I'm not going, you see, now we're covering all sorts of stuff. My mind, you know, because you can be a Christian and still have your mind. Am I right or wrong? You got certain likes, you got certain dislikes. I don't like that, you know. You know what I'm saying? Well, I don't like that. I hate that. You know, I've told this story a long, long time ago, but I remember when I was in Bible school, and I was up at the altar praying, and they had a big altar call, and there was, you know, there were hundreds of students in this Bible school. We had several hundred people. So an altar call was like big stuff. And I'm at the altar, and I'm pouring my heart out, and someone beside me leans over and says, your aftershave is offending me. I said, I'll try to get it to repent. No, I didn't say that. You know, I'm sure my aftershave offends a lot of people, but my thought at that moment was, I was pouring, I mean, I'm pouring out my heart. Oh, Jesus, I need you. And somebody's going, you know, I can't seek the Lord because of that smell. You know, well, what are you going to do? I mean, when we went to the mission field, the first place on the mission field they sent us was to the poor farm. And that's where they dumped people who were dying. And you went in there, and there was dead people in there, and there were diseased people. People would just pee on themselves or go to the restroom there. Rats were running all along the wall. I can't tell you the stench. We walked in there to minister to those people, and the smell was incredible. And of course, Deb immediately threw up, went out, and she was never able to go back. It was just horrible. But the Lord told me, you stay. And so I would get up in front of the people and I would share Jesus. And I would say, if anybody here just wants prayer, you know, if you want to receive the Lord, or if you already know the Lord and just want a hand on you, because most people, they were untouchable. That's what they're called, the untouchables. And people don't want to touch them. That's why they're thrown in this place. And so I'd go, you know, someone would raise their hand, I'd go over there and hold their hand. You know, this was before they had soft soap that kills 99% of all germs. Mm-hmm. Way before that. I mean, it was down to either God's with me or not. I mean, it really was. I mean, there's a good chance you can catch something here, you know. And I didn't care. I was 21 years old. I don't care. I'm here for Jesus and I'm here for you. Do you need me to pray? Would you pray for me? Sure. Would you pray for my family? I haven't been able to see them. I, you know, would like for somebody to come see me, you know. Many of these people, when we come back the next week, they're already dead and gone. What are we going to do if we, you know, well, I don't like how this pew feels, or I don't like, you know, the color of this room, or I don't like, you know, you see, all of that has nothing to do with Christ in us. We're not living the fulfilled life. We're living a life that if we're ever going to be fulfilled, God's going to have to line everything up perfectly according to my likes and dislikes. I mean, is that right or not? Fulfillment for us is when God gives me everything I want. But I got news for you. If God gave you everything you want, you'd probably be miserable. You know why? Because you'd find out that having all those things doesn't bring fulfillment. I remember when we first moved on Bolivar over one of our first locations as a church. And I was raised in Oak Cliff. I was raised in foster homes. I lived in orphanages. We never had any money. Never, you know. And we ended up having quite a few well-to-do people come to our church. One of them was Mike Wallace, and then he got robbed blind. And one of the people that came was just had all sorts of money at the time. They don't now, but at the time they did. Man, they had money. And so he'd say, well, I want to take you and your wife out to eat afterwards. And we'd go to the best restaurant, and we'd, you know, he'd order the best food. And then he'd fly me down to Houston, and just to, you know, we'd spend the night, and I'd share with him, you know, we'd just stay in the Ritzy hotel and stuff, and you know, I'd share with him, and then he'd take me to visit a few of his friends, and I'd talk to them about the Lord, and you know, he tithed and gave money, and I mean, he just had more money than I had ever seen. And we were talking about it once, and he said to me, and some of y'all heard me quote this, but he said to me, Randy, rich people know something that poor people don't know. I said, what's that? He said, money ain't the answer. He said, money isn't the answer. I would have said, money ain't the answer. I still say it. Because I'm just a poor boy from Oak Cliff. But when I heard that, I thought, now I don't know, man. I'm thinking, I could do with, you know. But, you know, you hear about these people that win the lottery and it ruins their lives. Anybody, I mean, most of the people that win the lottery go crazy and just screw up their lives royally. Because they don't know how to handle what little money they got. So when they get more, they just go nuts and do dumb things. And many of them are broke and poor and pretty short amount of time, because they don't know how to invest or to do this or whatever. Well, what my friend was trying to tell me was, in fact, he said, I've been to many a rich person's home, and he said, it's like a dungeon. He says, it's dark. He said, the kids are unhappy. He said, they don't get along. He said, I have been miserable myself. And he said, my wife and I, we said, okay, we're about to kill each other. We need to get away. Well, the truth is, you need to get away from each other, and then you need to get away from you. But he said, so here's what we're going to do. And so would fly to Tahiti and sit on the beach, watch the sun come up, sitting underneath the palm trees, arguing with one another. And he said the place didn't look good to me. He said, I never enjoyed a second of it. He said, I went there with problems and I came back from there with problems. You know? Some of you are young, so you don't know this yet. You can actually go to really cool places and not even enjoy the beauty of it. However, has anybody ever really liked somebody? And when you went somewhere really cool alone that was just beautiful or whatever, the main thought you had in your mind is, I wish so-and-so was here with me. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know why? Because it's twice as nice when you got love, when you're flowing, when there's fulfillment, when there's something to it. You understand? It's all wrapped up in true fulfillment now, not just having somebody. True fulfillment, and that is by Christ. By Christ. Because you can live years and, you know, have a good first 10 years, and you can pull out the pictures and look at them and reminisce during your divorce. What happens all the time, doesn't it? I'm telling you that Christianity is proven it, hadn't it? There's as many divorces in Christianity as there is in the world. Is that right or wrong? Yes, there is. It's caught up. It's equal. So Christianity isn't doing it any better than the world is. But Christ is. Christ in you, Christ in them, Christ in your children. Is Jesus totally formed in anyone? No, he's not. What should your goal be then? He must increase and I must decrease. We're back to burnt offering. We're back to when the sun comes up, when the sun goes down, there is a constant giving of the Lamb through you. You are living as a sacrifice. Present your bodies a living sacrifice and be not conformed to the world. You know? But what? Be renewed in the spirit of your mind, or be conformed to him. Be not conformed to the world, but be conformed to him. Well, folks, we say the world is out there drinking and carousing and doing all this stuff. No, the world is anything that's not Christ. There's the good people world, too. You know, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, there's good on that tree, too, not just bad, not just evil. And so, our part is to offer Christ, living as a, you know, in the way of the burnt offering, so that the Father is constantly getting the sweet savor. And it says that in the New Testament scripture, that we might be a sweet savor of Christ to God. Why? Because that's what's so sweet to God. Okay, now compare that scripture and the thought I just shared compared to the average Christian's thought is, and that is, oh, I need to live more sacrificially. Folks, that's not offering Christ, that's offering you. I mean, isn't it? It's, you know, it's not Christ being the fulfillment of the sacrifices through me right now. It is, you know, it's not. In the temple is where the sacrifices are being offered, right? I mean, they didn't, when they got the tabernacle and then went into the temple, folks, they didn't just walk out on the street and find a corner and then offer something up. Everything was offered up in the temple. We're trying to offer stuff up out here. Oh, I'll give you this, I'll give you this. What about you? No, not me, just this and this. You know, I'll give you many things, but not me. So, we look at those scriptures and we think in terms of copying Jesus, or we look at it like suffering. Living sacrifice means suffering. I mean, the first thought that comes in our mind is, what am I going to have to give up? What am I going to lose? I mean, that's really the thought. That's like, you know, I like this Acts Bible School stuff and everything, but if I ever got real with it, it would just make my life miserable. Well, that's the thought. And I want you to notice people around here that you think might actually live in accord with the cross and with offering Christ. And I mean, think of somebody. Somebody that's given. Somebody that's an altar for the Lord. Somebody that's a temple for the Lord. That when you go up to their body, you actually feel like you're going to the temple and you're meeting the Lord. You know? Think of that person that lives according to this and how miserable they are. Well, I mean, look at Kelly back there. Just incredibly miserable in her existence and bummed out because of all she's had to give up and lose. And just the sad, decrepit person she's become as a result of taking up the cross and following Jesus. Yeah, you can see it in her eyes. She can try to fake it with her smile, but we see it in her eyes. Oh, yeah, the old cheery front, but we know. Oh, God. It's pathetic, you know? You know? Okay, well, does that, I mean, if these things are true, they should free us, not put us in bondage. And I'm just here to tell you that maybe you're afraid because you don't really understand. And you're afraid of a wrong concept, not the truth. I just want you to consider that. What if you were actually afraid of a concept that had nothing to do with the truth? Or a person who got hold of the truth? What if all your fears visualize? I mean, it's like we have this little church out close to my house. I turn off on down the side road, and there's a little church, and it always has a sign up there. And right now the sign says, Jesus gave up everything. What have you given up? You know, I mean, if I was just a regular person and I read that, I would go, he was the savior of the world, for God's sake. You know, I'm not. I'm just a carpenter or whatever, you know. I'm just an electrician or something. But that's sort of the way that we present the cross. Instead of it being the fulfillment of everything, it's like, well, Jesus gave up everything, so, you know, we got some nails here for you. You know, we'll nail you right up. And then we'll rob you blind. That's what I thought when I read it. You know, Jesus gave up everything. You know, come on, give me everything. Like the preacher saying that or something, you know. You know, and you ought to do the same. If you do, you'll do it by Christ. And you'll do it unto the Father, and it'll be a glorious thing, and it'll be freeing. And I suggest that you never give in an offering out of guilt. God, first of all, God doesn't take bribes. So you can put it in there, but it's your loss. Don't do it. Don't give like that. Don't give like that. Either give because it's a burnout, you're just flowing with, you just want to bless the Lord, or don't give at all. Sit on it. Maybe you'll be rich someday. All right, well, I don't, you know, last two classes, it just seems like I have just, is anybody getting anything out of this? Well, thank God, because I sure ain't. We'll get into this later, but the burnt offering is not a one-time sacrifice. So Christ in us as the burnt offering is not a one-time sacrifice. It is a manifestation. It is an ever-flowing of his self-giving nature. It is how he lives. It is how he lives. Let's look at that scripture, just to look at it over in Galatians chapter 2. And I really believe that if we would read these things outside of a carnal mind, outside of a fear mentality, we would find a lot more peace in following Jesus. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Christ lives in me, and I'm just thoroughly bummed out about it. No, he doesn't say that. I don't get the feeling of somebody that's just a zombie. I don't think Paul was a zombie. And I'll tell you what, I don't think anybody who really gets hold of the cross is a zombie. I don't think anyone who really lets Christ live in them is a zombie. I think they're probably more true to themselves than anything else. Their true self, not the fallen self. This is basically saying, let's just try to listen to this in terms of Christian culture. This is saying that the way to satisfy God is to give him Christ in us and to make sure that it's not just us being gung-ho Christians. Now, every Bible school in the world is trying to make Christians more gung-ho. You understand gung-ho? You ever heard that? Huh, hoo-ah, you know. In the army, they'd say, what's the spirit of the bayonet? And we'd go, to kill! I became a medic, and I became a trainer of medics, and I'd say, what's the spirit of the medic? And they'd say, to heal! My little hippie influences back in those days. My little way of taking over, you know, taking it to the man, you know? But, you know, that gung-ho thing, and just getting people emotionally wrapped. Folks, there is a place and a time for God to move, and he will touch your emotions. I love it. In fact, last class, at the end of class, God touched you spirit, soul, and body. Thank the Lord for it. But what if you don't feel something? For the average Christian, if they don't feel something, they don't do anything. But for one who is a son of God or who Christ has formed in them, you do, not because you're motivated by a feeling. I mean, think about that. You're not motivated by a feeling. You're motivated by a life. Right? Well, you say, well, sometimes I get up and I just don't feel motivated. I just feel like a big lump of clay. Well, that's probably because that's what you are. Christ must be formed in us, you know? I mean, you know, we are, you know? We sing that song, you are the potter, I am the clay, you know? And so we just sit around all day as a big lump of clay waiting for him to shoot motivation in us. You know, get up, soldier! Well, the potter doesn't just do it that way in the New Testament. He lives in us. And he says, you are my body. Arise. You see what I'm saying? I mean, I don't really say to my body, arise, let's go. I mean, I'm tired and I'm worn out and I'm sweat more in the last 3 weeks, 4 weeks than I have in years. My pores are clean, but I'm dying. I mean, I fall asleep now during the day. I don't take naps or anything, but I start falling asleep. I go, I never do this. But it's, 100 and whatever. The other day it was way up there, and I worked all day in that the whole time. But I can feel the difference between my body and between Christ in me. I mean, I don't know what words to use. I can feel the difference between my body and Christ. I can tell, and my body will say, like for example, we'll be working and stuff, and we'll have lunch, and that's only halfway through the day. My feet are hurting, I'm tired, I'm worn out, and I don't want to get up after lunch. I want to just sort of, I'm sitting on the floor eating anyway. I want to just lean over, slide over, and go to sleep. That's what, and my body's saying, just slide over. Do it. Just quit. It's okay. These boxes will move themselves. And just as clear, I can feel the Lord in me. Not necessarily saying anything, but just get up. He gets up. My body gets up. Moves forward. You just do what you know you got to do. And I appreciate it. Was yesterday, I think, Kevin came out. And Kevin and I have been together a long time. It's been a lot of years. Yeah, and we were over on the Maple property having to work. And when we moved into this Bible school, it didn't look anything like this. And we had to climb up in the ceiling when it was hot like it is and put pipes together and run pipes and do all this stuff, you know. And so Kevin come walking in the door yesterday, and I'm like got a t-shirt on or something, just in there working, just sweating. I got a sweat rag. I just constantly wipe myself. Kevin said, "Well, I see you're working away." And I said, "Yeah, just from the time I get up to the time I go to bed, every day, been doing it, week in and week out, in this heat." Kevin sort of pauses for a second. He goes, "Just like you've always done it ever since I've known you, Randy." He says, "Nothing new here." And I went, you know, there's some truth to that. This place looks pretty good now. I'm thankful for it. I mean, we got air conditioning in here.
Amen.
I'm telling you, folks, and you know, this is nothing other than facts. Can you imagine having classes with no air conditioning? I remember, no, because you're not imagining. You were there. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to them. But I remember on Maple, my God, it was incredibly hot, and we're just sweating, and we're just, but you know, I don't know, man, when you're just hungry for Jesus, you go through, you'll do whatever you got to do, you know. I'm sure we're going to eventually have somebody quit the Bible school because there's not enough air conditioning, when there's more than we've ever had before. But I'm sure that somebody will stay because they can't do without Jesus, no matter how bad it is, no matter what they're having to face, whether it's heat outwardly or they're going through the heat inwardly. You know what I'm saying? Because we do. I mean, there's heat around here just as much inwardly as there is outwardly, isn't there? It's tough, you know. People call up and say, "Well, I'd like to go to the Bible school." And we say, "Well, this place is tough. You don't want to, you know." I mean, we've told people that. You need to really pray. Make sure this is the Lord. You know. We have. And we've had people say, no, it can't be that bad. You're just trying to scare me up. No, I'm just trying to tell you the truth. Yeah, trying to save you. But there really is a heat around here that where you're going through the heat, God sees to it that you go through the heat, that you, that there's inward things that hurt or that pull you or that upset you or whatever. And God's saying, are you going to let the heat drive you away? You know? You heard the old saying, if you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen. I say, if you can't stand the heat, let Jesus live in you. That's simple. Because I can't stand the heat. I'm not talking about the outward. There's stuff going on all the time. I can't take it. But Jesus can. And he does. And somehow, I don't know how, other than life. I just call it life. Somehow he overcomes my fears. And when I say that now, I don't want to, let me just make sure I say this clearly. How much time we got? 5 minutes? That he doesn't relieve all my fears. He overcomes them. He overrides them. He picks me up and he keeps me going when I want to quit. Anybody, come on, we only got a few minutes here. Anybody here, at some juncture, you wanted to go out of this place screaming and God kept you? Go ahead and raise your hand if that's happened. Come on, keep them up. Up, 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 up. Now, everyone look around. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people. Was it, what was your name? Carrie, is that one? Casey, pretty name. Run! I mean, that's a lot of hands. But you know why it is? It's not just because this place is bad. It's because God is burning off the dross. Do you hear me? He's burning off the dross. We don't want to keep the dross and get rid of the gold, amen? We love the Lord too much. We want the Lord too much. And in some cases, there's dross in other people that are trying to run you off. You know, I mean, you'd be surprised how many people have left because of me. Yeah. You know what? Because I've got dross in me. You better believe it. You got it. I got it. There are things that where Christ hadn't been formed in me. I'm not perfect. And people have left because of that. But you know what? When I was in Bible school, there was dross in my leaders and stuff, and it was like they were trying to run me off, and I told them, I'm not leaving. I need Jesus. I can't afford to leave. I'm staying. Please don't kick me out, I said. I need Jesus, and I know he's here, and I'm going to get Jesus, and I'm going to put up with your dross. I mean, I've put up with other people's dross. My God, I worked with JW for years. And you can tell him that. He already knows. I've told him many times. You know, I mean, there's stuff in him that's tried to drive me off and whatever. But if you want the Lord, you'll get the Lord. But you're going to have to, you might have to put up with some stuff to get him. Amen? But I promise you this, the Lord is better than anything you have to go through. That's why we call him Sweet Jesus. That he is so worth it. He's so worth it. I'm telling you, he's so worth it. All right, well, we barely introduced this thing of the living sacrifice. But I worry that if I keep going the rate I'm going, we will never cover all this. So I'm going to try to move on after this. Maybe have a little more on the living sacrifice. But let's take a break and we'll come back. And let's try to do it in about 5 to 10 minutes. Let's have a shorter break this time.